What is universal suffrage? When was it achieved? And who were its key players? Let's find out in today's episode of the History Chronicles. Hello, I'm Alex, and welcome to the History Chronicles. If you like our work, then please don't forget to like and subscribe. And if you'd like to support the channel in return for exclusive perks, please visit our Patreon page. Now, on with the video. Today's History Chronicle begins on the morning of the 17th of April 1969 in the chamber of the House of Commons, where the Speaker of the House, Dr. Horace King, rises from his chair and announces to the MPs sitting there that the Queen has given royal assent to a number of acts. Surround the sea of faces cast against the green leather backs of the benches in the Commons, and calls out, "I have to notify the House in accordance with the Royal Assent Act 1967 that the Queen has signified her royal assent to the Representation of the People Act 1969. The Act, now enshrined in law, gives men and women over the age of 18 years the right to vote in general and local elections in the United Kingdom, the basis of universal suffrage in the UK, and broadly representative of the current legal status of voters in the UK in the present day." But before we can understand the universal suffrage which the Act has just delivered, we must take a journey back to ancient Athens, the place which many consider to be the birthplace of democracy. The term democracy is taken from the Greek demokratia, often translated to mean people rule, and, according to the majority of academics, has its origins in the ancient Greek city-state of Athens. The city itself was renowned in the region, a powerful hub of political and commercial activity perched on the coast of the Saronic Gulf, with its glistening white buildings radiant in the Mediterranean sun. The grandest of them all, the Acropolis Citadel, perched atop a rock in the centre of the city. Whilst it is often seen as the birthplace of modern democracy, the politics of the present would have seemed totally alien to the Athenian citizen, who engaged with the political system in a completely different manner to that of today. For one, the Athenian system worked through personal or direct representation, with men of the city attending sessions of the assembly in person and voting on the matters which were put before them, all having the opportunity to speak their mind on anything that interested or bothered them. Citizens would sit and listen to one another speak atop the Nix, a hill in the centre of the city, and they would talk to one another about the issues of their day, the state of Athens' defences, her navy, her taxation laws, and her markets. This was a system that allowed Athenians to directly participate in their political system. Another major difference between the democracy of today and that of Athens was that Athenian democracy was subject to major criticism from a wide array of writers. Many critics of Athenian democracy lamented the fact that it gave power to the poor, the uninformed, and the gullible. Aristophanes wrote of democracy as an old man who had been tricked and bewildered by a flashy and impressive tyrant, whilst Plato argued that democracy left the city-state and its citizens in a position of effective anarchy. The democratic politics of today, of elections and televised debates, of campaign trails and hustings, was a world away from the everyday experience of democracy in ancient Athens, a city so often thought of as the root of the modern democratic tree. But despite the differences between modern and ancient democracy, Athens did plant a seed of political theory which has come to define the democratic experience for all people: the need for representation. Some Athenians were able to represent themselves directly in their assembly, provided that they were citizens, male and non-slaves, and wealthy enough to take time away from their work to go to the Nix, a criteria which prevented the majority of the city's population from taking part in the political processes which governed it. However, modern states are far larger than their ancient counterparts. Athens, one of the largest Hellenic city-states, had a population of a few thousand, whilst the largest democracy today, India, has 1.366 billion citizens as of 2019. The dynamics of representation have certainly changed a great deal since citizens gathered atop hills in the centre of Athens in the 5th century BC. It would certainly be a tall order to gather hundreds of millions of people in a single assembly today. Most modern democracy centres on a form of indirect representation, rather than the direct democracy practiced in Athens. We can't all assemble and discuss important matters, so we elect other people to do it for us. The right to vote for these representatives is referred to as suffrage. Those with suffrage can vote for representatives, a right seen by many now to be universal to all people over a certain age and who qualify legally as citizens. Suffrage in the United Kingdom has a winding path, and one which cannot be easily defined. Voting in elections did not always mean representation, which is the fundamental right many now associate with the ability to vote. The general election of 1761 was lively in King's Lynn, a town at the very top of the county of Norfolk. One candidate standing that year, Horace Walpole, the youngest son of the first British Prime Minister Robert Walpole, wrote in his diary that he was bemused at the crowds who had gathered despite the chilly spring weather, and moaned about the many conversations that he had held with voters. Walpole grumbled that his house smelt of tobacco and punch. His floors were filthy because person after person had trailed mud in with them, and he had been forced to speak again and again to the people he had sat in Parliament for since 1757, a long day which had left him weary. Walpole's tiring day of campaigning was shared by barely anyone else. He was re-elected in 1761 and remained in office until 1769, one of fewer than 100 MPs who stood for election that year, the rest keeping their seats uncontested, and fewer than 500 voters actually going to the polls and voting for their representatives, out of a total population of 6.15 million. Indeed, it didn't matter all that much, since the government at the time, a Whig administration under the leadership of Thomas Pelham Hollis, 1st Duke of Newcastle, already had a massive lead over their Tory opponents. The election, little more than a reaffirmation of the power which they already had. Many historians have noted the role of patronage and fraternisation in these elections, a vast number of the results predetermined and widely known before they were actually announced, meaning that even those who were able to vote were scarcely ever truly represented. The election of 1761 was a pretty poor show for democracy, even for the time. But many key factors of it were commonplace. The massively low turnout, the predetermination of the result, and the retention of power by politicians who had the king's favour regardless of what the country thought of them. A system which would remain broadly in place until 1832, when Lord Grey, the then Prime Minister, decided to shake it up and introduced the Reform Bill. Prime Minister Charles Grey, 2nd Earl Grey, was an enthusiastic reformer and had a penchant for electoral reform, as well as tea. Earl Grey tea is named after the blend of leaves and bergamot he favoured. He introduced several key acts, including the Slavery Abolition Act of 1833. The other key law which he is often remembered for is the Reform Act of 1832, which he introduced to the House a year after assuming office. His predecessor, the Duke of Wellington, the man once renowned for his defeat of Napoleon at Waterloo, had been booed out of the House in 1830, when he angrily proclaimed that he would resist any effort to introduce electoral reform, leading a short while later to Grey becoming Prime Minister. His reformist credentials already well established. The 1832 Act had massive provisions for reform. It abolished rotten boroughs, which were small constituencies, sometimes containing single families, who would vote with a 100% majority for MPs who were very often their close personal friends, as well as enfranchised holders of copyhold land valued at over £10, and male householders who lived in properties valued at over £10, whilst creating additional parliamentary seats and creating a system of voter oversight and mediation. Grey had made waves in England's franchise, but several significant limitations remained. The middle class had largely been given the vote, although the working class remained without, as they could not meet the property qualification demand by the government, leading to the rise of the Chartist movement, which remained a powerful force for working class empowerment until the 1850s. Grey's government had also failed to enfranchise women, who were not included in the property qualification, which specifically stated that men would be able to vote, in effect meaning that women were now formally excluded from voting in general elections, whereas before the Act, some women had in fact voted. The 4th of November 1839 saw a cold, brisk day break in Newport, South Wales, where the cries of 4,000 Chartist protesters split the air, led by John Frost, a native of Monmouthshire, and an avid reader of Thomas Paine, who led the chanting crowds into the city centre from the outskirts. En route, several protesters were grabbed by the British Army, who had been deployed to manage the protest and protect the police who had lined the streets in their wake, and dragged into the Westgate Hotel, a pretty five-storey building in the French Renaissance style. The Chartists turned back to the hotel, keen on freeing their comrades, and were met by the 45th Regiment of Foot, a formidable force resplendent in red tunics and white buckskin ammunition pouches, who proceeded to take aim and fire at the protesters as they thronged the street outside the hotel. The once relatively peaceful protest had become a massacre. 22 protesters were confirmed dead after the shooting, and a further 50 injured, the melee lasting about half an hour, turning the flagstoned street into a killing field. The Newport Rising has been called the last great rising in Britain by some historians. But despite the scale of the event, little changed in government in terms of support for electoral reform, and the Chartist movement itself was to die out a couple of decades later, after the last effective leader of the movement, Fergus O'Connor, suffered a mental breakdown and took to assaulting MPs as they debated one another in the chamber of the House of Commons. Several other organisations staged protests over the same period. One massive demonstration in Hyde Park, staged by the Reform League, had rendered the government unable to shut it down. An embarrassment which led the Home Secretary, Spencer Walpole, to resign. The interim had seen great pressure from the Chartist movement applied to cabinets of all parties, pressure which they all managed to resist, despite riots and outbreaks of violence in favour of the extension of the franchise. Although some, such as the great Prime Minister Benjamin Disraeli, attempted to introduce a reform bill in 1859. Despite this, the 19th century was a time of great change for suffrage in the United Kingdom, and additional reform was not far away from those changes made by Earl Grey in the 1830s. Another act, the 1867 Reform Act, was passed to great effect under the then Prime Minister Edward Smith Stanley, the 14th Earl of Derby, a Conservative. The historian Francis Walsh hailed Smith Stanley as a founder of the modern Conservative Party, marking their new-fashioned credentials with the passage of the Reform Act, the last great Whig measure, which led to the enfranchisement of over a third of the male population of England, which included urban householders as well as their counterparts in the countryside, rural landowners. The British political elite had finally taken a greater interest in electoral extension following the turbulence of the latter 19th century. The victory of the Union in the US Civil War, as well as the death of Viscount Palmerston, had provided flashpoints of debate over reform, as well as the writings of several influential authors, ranging from Anthony Trollope, Karl Marx, and Walter Badgett, all of whom argued that an extension of the franchise would be a moral policy to follow, an argument also advanced by William Gladstone, who would later become Prime Minister himself. Palmerston had been a thorn in the side of the Conservatives for quite some time. His powerful image as leader of the Liberals had given the opposition great power in Parliament and prevented the Conservatives from pursuing any reform around the franchise. Disraeli and Smith Stanley had come into government with one another in 1866. Disraeli as Chancellor of the Exchequer and Smith Stanley as Prime Minister. A powerful alliance which afforded the Tories a new opportunity to break back into the political game after Palmerston's death. William Ewart Gladstone had become the leader of the Liberal Party in 1867. The two-time Chancellor of the Exchequer threatening to once again undermine the newfound power of the Tories with his charismatic personality and connections on the Conservative bench. Disraeli and Smith Stanley realised that the extension of the franchise would be their one great chance at swinging the favour of Parliament and the nation in their favour, and so embarked on a plan to introduce a bill to the Commons advocating for a greater lowering of the qualifications demanded of those who needed to vote. The bill was a political flop for the Tories. It enfranchised a far greater number of men than they had expected due to the rise in the value of payments after the compounding of rent, leading effectively to the enfranchisement of all male heads of household after 1868, a new voting population who put their weight behind the Liberal leader, Gladstone, causing him to be appointed Prime Minister in that year's election. Elections remained highly corrupt, and many voters were swayed in their decision by threats from their employers and landowners who pressured them to vote for their favoured MP, a matter which the new Liberal government sought to address. Indeed, Gladstone was something of a reformer himself when it came to the franchise, and oversaw the passage of the 1872 Ballot Act, which made provisions for the process of secret ballots in elections, giving greater independence and privacy to voters in order that they not be pressured to vote for certain candidates, an attack on the much-lamented corruption mentioned before. The next great stage in the extension of the franchise came thick and fast in 1884, yet again under Gladstone, and extended the property qualifications introduced by Smith Stanley in 1867 to the countryside, giving the vote to all men paying £10 of rent per year and those with land valued at £10. The act was monumental in expanding the number of persons with the vote, increasing the electorate to 5,500,000 persons in total, and set into precedent the practice of having a single MP per seat. The bill, yet again, left massive gaps. 60% of men and all women were still unable to vote, although the increasing favour of men under these new rules led some women to start their own dedicated fight for the vote, soon to emerge in the suffragette movement. The formation of the suffragette movement took place formally in 1903. Although massive moves had been made to extend the franchise to women, both in the UK and around the world, New Zealand had enfranchised women in 1893, and MPs such as John Stuart Mill had been elected to Parliament as early as 1865 on a manifesto which backed female enfranchisement. Organisations such as the Kensington Society had already formed with the intention of pushing for the right for women to vote, as had the Women's Suffrage Committee in Manchester, which had worked alongside the Independent Labour Party since 1867, in order to forge a political coalition in order to push for women to have the right to vote. The formation of political organisations designed for this end reached an apex at the turn of the 19th century. Although many grew increasingly exasperated at the techniques employed by the larger organisations, seeing them as ineffective and slow. Emmeline Pankhurst and her daughter Christabel were two such women, who in 1903 broke away from the National Union of Women's Suffrage Societies and founded their own movement, the Women's Social and Political Union, or WSPU, which they hoped would move toward more active campaigning methods in order to fight for women. In 1905, the WSPU demonstrated their new tactics by disrupting speeches given by politicians in Manchester, including those given by Winston Churchill, asking him whether or not he backed the right of women to vote, and if he supported women's rights, leading to the arrest of both Christabel Pankhurst and her friend Annie Kenny. In 1908, the WSPU formalised their colour scheme of purple, white and green, symbolising loyalty, purity and hope. Colours which featured heavily on the sashes and rosettes worn by activists from the movement as they attended protests and demonstrations. Between 1905 and 1912, the WSPU engaged in largely peaceful fundraising and awareness campaigns, leafleting and marching, as well as designing board games, which they sold in order to raise funds for the organisation. However, 1912 marked a change in the approach of the WSPU, who instigated a campaign in which activists would smash windows with rocks, a move largely prompted by Christabel Pankhurst, and opposed by others in the movement, such as the editor of the WSPU's newspaper, Votes for Women, Emmeline Pethick Lawrence. Their new campaign led to the arrest of Pethick Lawrence, although Pankhurst managed to evade the law by running to France, leading the former to leave the WSPU and publish the newspaper in opposition to their tactics. In response, Pankhurst founded another newspaper called the Suffragette. The new suffragette movement grew ever more radical and bombed churches as well as the homes of politicians. St. Martin in the Fields, the famed church in Trafalgar Square, London, was damaged by a bomb, as was Reginald McKenna's home in 1914, amongst many other targets. 1913 saw 250 attacks linked to the suffragette movement, who had managed to create an atmosphere of great panic amongst the population. Their acts included arson, bomb, and violent attacks against buildings and individuals considered to be influential in British society. The 4th of June 1913 was a sunny, warm day, a fair breeze wafting over the face of Emily Davidson as she left the WSPU's offices in Clements Inn, just off the Strand in London, carrying with her two banners emblazoned with the colours of the suffragette movement. The famous Epsom Derby was on that day, and it was to the racecourse in Surrey that Davidson headed, walking around the track until she reached the final bend before the home straight, known as the Tattenham Corner. Waiting in the warm afternoon, Davidson watched as the band of horses racing that day moved round the track, their riders urging them on to speeds of 35 miles an hour in a bid to be the first ones over the finish line. Davidson watched one rider in particular, Herbert Jones, who rode Anmer, the king's horse, that of George V. She ducked under the barriers and reached for the reins of the animal, in the process being struck by it and killed. Three news cameras picked up the event, which sparked a massive debate amongst the British elite, the Queen angrily writing that Davidson had been a horrid woman in her diary. A grand funeral procession was held for her in Northumberland, where her parents had both hailed from. The state crackdown on the suffragette movement continued into the First World War, with thousands of women being arrested for their involvement with the movement and subjected to force feeding and even death as a consequence of hunger strikes. Women had tubes inserted through their noses or directly into their stomachs in order to prevent them from engaging in hunger strikes, leading the WSPU to increase the militancy of their actions. The government passing the Prisoners Act in 1913, which largely stopped the need to force feed, as those on hunger strikes would simply be released from prison until they had eaten again and broken the strike, whereupon they would be re-detained. The First World War changed the role and the place of the WSPU in society, as they began to use the war effort to demonstrate that women had the same capacity to perform male roles in society. Meeting the needs of the state, who needed civilian aid for roles formerly performed by men who had signed up to the armed forces after the outbreak of war. Women worked in factories and on the land, allowing representative organizations such as the National Union of Women's Suffrage Societies to gain political traction, in turn affording a compromise to come into existence between them and the government, finally resulting in the passage of the 1918 Representation of the People Act, enfranchising all men over the age of 21 and all women over the age of 30, who met certain property qualifications. The British electorate now included men of all classes and women of a certain class, a reform which allowed the makeup of the House of Commons to change dramatically. The first female MPs, Constance Markievicz and Nancy Astor, were elected in 1918 and 1919 respectively, and the new electorate used their political weight to increase the share of votes gained by Labour and the Liberals in the 1918 election. Equal franchise between men and women was finally reached in 1928, with the passage of the 1928 Representation of the People's Act, a reform which allowed all women over the age of 21 the vote, in line with the legal status of men, making women an effective majority with 52% of the vote. The Prime Minister Stanley Baldwin wrote to Millicent Fawcett, the famous campaigner for the NUWSS, to assure her that he felt the bill would be passed without any significant amendment. The final bill passed on the legal status of those who were enfranchised was the so-called Sixth Reform Act, passed in 1969 under Harold Wilson, the then Labour Prime Minister, which lowered the voting age from 21 to 18 for all citizens who met the qualification defined in the previous 1928 Act, and allowed students to vote in their university town, after a challenge from the student body of Churchill College, Cambridge. By 1928, the United Kingdom had achieved equality for both men and women in terms of their right and ability to vote in general elections, procuring what is now often called universal suffrage. But the UK was neither the first nor the last country to gain universal suffrage. The Republic of Haiti legislated universal male suffrage in 1816, whilst the Second French Republic had the same from 1848. In 1867, all men got the vote in the North German Confederation, and all slaves were granted the same right of universal male suffrage in the US after the conclusion of the US Civil War, and the ratification of the 15th Amendment to the US Constitution. The fight for the enfranchisement of women dragged on for a greater period of time, New Zealand being the first territory to enfranchise some women in 1893, followed by South Australia in 1894. The greatest advance was made by the Grand Duchy of Finland, allowing unrestricted universal suffrage in 1906. However, there were several clarifications in many countries which changed the nature of universal suffrage. Australia, for instance, did not enfranchise Aboriginal citizens until 1962. In many other countries, enfranchisement has been far more recent. Saudi Arabia, for instance, enfranchised women in 2015, although as the country has had few elections, 7 in the past 80 years, and operates as a monarchical state, this has meant very little. The fight for enfranchisement has reached new heights in some stable democracies, with many seeing increased support for the enfranchisement of people aged under 18 years old, many suggesting a new age base of 16. Although some states already do this, Iran formerly had a voting age of 15, whilst Australia, Brazil, and Cuba all allow 16-year-old citizens to vote. Universal suffrage is of immense importance in modern states. Citizens lack the ability to represent themselves in person due to the nature of development of modern democracy, which flourished in states too vast and populated to imitate the system of direct democracy in Athens. This new representative democracy has often been seen as one which represents only those who can and do vote, with many arguing that the greater the base of enfranchisement, the more representative elected political institutions will be of their population. Universal suffrage has been seen as a hallmark of political modernity, the bestowment of essential political and human rights to all citizens who, along with their right to vote, gain the right to be represented in their legislature and government. Many challenges continue to affect universal suffrage today. Some states, such as Myanmar, use elections to placate their population at times of angst. Saudi Arabia holds few elections at all. and many others have highly corrupt elections, where certain candidates win seats regardless of how the population voted. In these states, universal suffrage is a secondary matter, the greatest issue being the legitimation of formal elections in the first place. In other, more stable democracies, such as the US, the UK and India, turnout remains a potent threat to representative democracy. Incumbent representatives have an ever smaller mandate from an ever narrower section of the population, tying them to fewer voters and lowering their level of legitimacy. Representative democracy relies on universal suffrage in order to fulfill its task of being representative, a battle which has taken centuries in many countries, such as the United Kingdom, which we've examined today. You've been watching the History Chronicles. We'd love to know what you think of universal suffrage and the suffragettes. Please let us know below, and if you enjoyed our video, please give us a like and subscribe. It really helps us out. Also, if you'd like to support our work going forward, please visit our Patreon page. We look forward to seeing you again on the next episode of the History Chronicles.